According to Albert Einstein's theory of relativity, the only thing that is faster than the speed of light is the expansion of the universe. This means that the universe is expanding at an incredible rate, making it almost impossible to explore it in its entirety. Thus far, humanity has depended on traditional methods of propulsion, which have allowed us to explore some parts of our solar system. However, if we wish to go beyond our galactic neighborhood, we must find a way to travel faster in the vacuum of space. The latest reports suggest that NASA has finally perfected the design of a helical engine that breaks the laws of physics. So, let's take a closer look. The closest star to Earth is Proxima Centauri. It's about 4.25 light-years away, or about 25 trillion miles. The fastest-ever spacecraft, the now-in-space Parker Solar Probe, will reach a top speed of 450,000 miles per hour. It would take just 20 seconds to go from Los Angeles to New York City at that speed, but it would take the Solar Probe about 6,633 years to reach Earth's nearest neighboring solar system. If humanity ever wants to travel easily between stars, people will need to go faster than light. But so far, faster than light travel is possible only in science fiction. In Isaac Asimov's Foundation series, humanity can travel from planet to planet, star to star, or across the universe using jump drives. We have all read many such stories in our youth, and these same stories are what inspire scientists today to find alternative ways humanity can travel in space. Some characters, like the astronauts in the movies Interstellar and Thor, use wormholes to travel between solar systems in seconds. Another approach, familiar to Star Trek fans, is warp drive technology. Warp drives are theoretically possible, if still far-fetched technology. Two recent papers made headlines when researchers claimed to have overcome one of the many challenges that stand between the theory of warp drives and reality. But how do these theoretical warp drives work? And will humans be making the jump to warp speed anytime soon? Physicists' current understanding of space-time comes from Albert Einstein's theory of general relativity. General relativity states that space and time are fused and that nothing can travel faster than the speed of light. General relativity also describes how mass and energy warp space-time. Hefty objects like stars and black holes curve space-time around them. This curvature is what you feel as gravity and why many spacefaring heroes worry about getting stuck in or falling into a gravity well. Early science fiction writers John Campbell and Asimov saw this warping as a way to skirt the speed limit. What if a starship could compress space in front of it while expanding space-time behind it? Star Trek took this idea and named it the warp drive. In 1994, Miguel Alcubierre, a Mexican theoretical physicist, showed that compressing space-time in front of the spaceship while expanding it behind was mathematically possible within the laws of general relativity. So what does that mean? Imagine the distance between two points is 10 meters. If you're standing at point A and can travel 1 meter per second, it would take 10 seconds to get to point B. However, let's say you could somehow compress the space between you and point B so that the interval is now just 1 meter. Then, moving through space-time at your maximum speed of 1 meter per second, you would be able to reach point B in about 1 second. In theory, this approach does not contradict the laws of relativity, since you are not moving faster than light in the space around you. Alcubierre showed that the warp drive from Star Trek was theoretically possible. Unfortunately, Alcubierre's method of compressing space-time had one problem. It requires negative energy or negative mass. Alcubierre's warp drive would work by creating a bubble of flat space-time around the spaceship and curving space-time around that bubble to reduce distances. The warp drive would require either negative mass, a theorized type of matter, or a ring of negative energy density to work. Physicists have never observed negative mass, so that leaves negative energy as the only option. To create negative energy, a warp drive would use a huge amount of mass to create an imbalance between particles and antiparticles. For example, if an electron and an anti-electron appear near the warp drive, one of the particles would get trapped by the mass, and this results in an imbalance. This imbalance results in negative energy density. Alcubierre's warp drive would use this negative energy to create the space-time bubble. But for a warp drive to generate enough negative energy, you would need a lot of matter. Alcubierre estimated that a warp drive with a 100-meter bubble would require the mass of the entire visible universe. In 1999, physicist Chris Vandenbroek showed that expanding the volume inside the bubble, but keeping the surface area constant, would reduce the energy requirement significantly to just about the mass mass of the Sun. A significant improvement, but still far beyond all practical possibilities. Two recent papers, one by Alexei Bobrik and Gianni Martier, and another by Eric Lentz, provide solutions that seem to bring warp drives closer to reality. Bobrik and Martier realized that by modifying space-time within the bubble in a certain way, they could remove the need to use a negative energy. This solution, though, does not produce a warp drive that can go faster than light. Independently, Lentz also proposed a solution that does not require negative energy. He used a different geometric approach to solve the equations of general relativity, and by doing so, he found that a warp drive wouldn't need to use negative energy. Lentz's solution would allow the bubble to travel faster than the speed of light. It is essential to point out that these exciting developments are mathematical models. The scientific community won't fully trust these models until there is experimental proof. Yet, the science of warp drives is coming into view. Innovative thinking on this subject is crucial to making the dream of interstellar travel a reality. In the words of Captain Picard, things are only impossible until they are not. Another recently proposed method that could solve the problem is an EM drive. The design claims to make the impossible possible. It uses a method of pushing spacecraft around without the need for propulsion or an exhaust. But the EM drive doesn't just violate our fundamental understanding of the universe. The experiments that claim to measure an effect haven't been replicated. It goes by various names: the EM drive, the Q drive, the RF resonant cavity, the impossible drive. But all the incarnations of the device claim to do the same thing: bounce some radiation around inside a closed chamber, and you can get propulsion. This is a big deal because all forms of rocketry require conservation of momentum. To set yourself in motion, you have to push off of something. Your feet push off the ground, airplanes push themselves off of the air, and rockets push parts of themselves out the back end to make them go forward. But the M drive doesn't. It's just a box with microwaves inside it bouncing around, and supposedly it can move. Explanations for how the M-drive could work go past the boundaries of known physics. Perhaps it's somehow interacting with the quantum vacuum energy of space-time. Perhaps our understanding of momentum is broken. Perhaps it's some brand new physics heralded by the M-drive experiments. Conservation of momentum is pretty straightforward. In a closed system, you can add up all the momenta of all the objects in that system. Then they interact. Then you add up the momenta of all the objects again. The total momentum at the beginning must equal the total momentum at the end, and this means that momentum is conserved. The idea of the conservation of momentum has been with us for centuries. It's even implied by Newton's famous second law, but in the early 1900s it gained a new status. The brilliant mathematician Emmy Noether proved that conservation of momentum, along with other conservation laws, like conservation of energy, is a reflection of the fact that our universe has certain symmetries. For example, you can choose a suitable location to perform a physics experiment. You can then pick up your physics experiment, transport it to anywhere in the universe, and repeat it. As long as you account for environmental differences, say different air pressures or gravitational fields, your results will be identical. This is a symmetry of nature. Physics doesn't care about where experiments take place. Noether realized that this symmetry of space directly leads to the conservation of momentum. You can't have one without the other. So, if the M drive demonstrates a violation of momentum conservation, which it claims to do, then this fundamental symmetry of nature must be broken. But almost every single physical theory, from Newton's laws to quantum field theory, expresses space symmetry and momentum conservation in their base equations. Indeed, most modern theories of physics are simply complicated restatements of momentum conservation. To find a crack in this symmetry wouldn't just be an extension of known physics, it would completely upend centuries of understanding of how the universe works. That's certainly not impossible. Scientific revolutions have happened before, but it's going to take a lot of convincing to make that happen. And the experiments so far have not been all that satisfying. Ever since the introduction of the M-drive concept in 2001, every few years a group claims to have measured a net force coming from its device. But these researchers are measuring an incredibly tiny effect, a force so small it couldn't even budge a piece of paper. This leads to a significant statistical uncertainty and measurement error. Indeed, of all the published results, none have produced a measurement beyond barely qualifying for publication, let alone anything significant. Still, other groups have developed their own M drives, attempting to replicate the results, as good scientists should. Those replication attempts either fail to measure anything at all, or find some confounding variable that can easily explain the measured meager results, like the interaction of the cabling in the device with the Earth's magnetic field. Thankfully, one of the biggest traits of humanity is our drive to find solutions to difficult problems. And this is what NASA scientist David Burns has been doing in his spare time. Unfazed by the failures of the M drive, he has produced an engine concept that he says could theoretically accelerate to 99% of the speed of light, all without using propellant. On paper, his design works by exploiting the way mass can change at relativistic speeds, those close to the speed of light in a vacuum. It has not yet been reviewed by an expert. Understandably, this paper has caused buzz approaching levels seen in the early days of the EM drive. And yet, even some headlines claim that the engine could violate the laws of physics. But while this concept is fascinating, it's not going to break physics anytime soon. As a thought experiment to explain his concept, Burns describes a box with a weight inside, threaded on a line, with a spring at each end, bouncing the weight back and forth. In a vacuum, such as space, the effect of this would be to wiggle the entire box, with the weight seeming to stand still. Overall, the box would stay wiggling in the same spot, but if the mass of the weight were to increase in only one direction, it would generate a greater push in that direction, and therefore thrust. According to the principle of the conservation of momentum, in which the momentum of a system remains constant in the absence of any external forces, this should be not completely possible. However, there is a loophole. According to special relativity, objects gain mass as they approach light speed. So if you replace the weight with ions and the box with a loop, you can theoretically have the ions moving faster at one end of the loop and slower at the other. But Burns's drive isn't a single closed loop. It's helical, like a stretched out spring, hence helical engine. The engine accelerates ions confined in a loop to moderate, relativistic speeds and then varies their velocity to make slight changes in their mass. The engine then moves ions back and forth along the direction of travel to produce thrust. The engine has no moving parts other than ions traveling in a vacuum line, trapped inside electric and magnetic fields. While the concept sounds interesting in theory, it comes with significant practical problems. One such problem is that the helical chamber would have to be pretty large, around 656 feet long and 40 feet in diameter, to be precise. And it would need to generate 165 megawatts of energy to produce 1 newton of thrust. That's the equivalent to the output of a power station to produce the force required to accelerate a kilogram of mass per second squared. So a lot of input for a teeny tiny output. It is inefficient, but in the vacuum of space, it just might work. Burns believes that the engine itself would be able to get to 99% the speed of light if you had enough time and power. Burns notes the efficiency problem in his presentation and also adds that his work hasn't been reviewed by experts and there may be errors in his math. We don't exactly have the blueprints for a fully functional space travel engine here, but what we do have is a piece of groundwork that could be used to develop such an engine. What we have is a dream of the stars. If you enjoyed this video, please consider checking out this one, which talks about 5 discoveries that James Webb Space Telescope is expected to make. If the helical engine works, would you consider going on a journey across interstellar space? Please share your thoughts in the comments section below.